sociological issue. I posit that setting the ontology right first is a definite priority in all studies to safeguard the validity and usefulness of their findings, because the ontological framing and assumptions critically influence the problem definition and pertinent theorizing, analysis, and governance recommendations. The majority of applied studies exhibit either ontological reductionism, the reduction of ontology whole, or an ontological void, they do not discuss ontology at all. Assembly thinking provides an alternative to both. It is an integrative notion that captures the dynamic constitution of complex objects of reference out of multifarious components through practice and underscores the unique character becoming a facility of the emergent individual singularities that possess agents. So I will discuss some basic issues, starting from conceptualizing and theorizing. In applied studies, the common approach, the common tendency, is to treat concepts as homogeneous and differentiate with an ambiguous, uniform, and identical meaning across individual places and time, to disregard the particular context of application and use, and positive or negative connotations and moral undertones historically acquired in particular scientific and sociocultural contexts are often uncritically adopted and remain invariable when the concepts are transferred to other contexts. Examples are each word we are using. The assembly-based approach treats concepts as non-homogeneous that are assembled out of human and non-human components, reflecting an ontology of becoming. Praxis and the purpose of praxis come center stage. Praxis are the habitual and other practices and mechanisms through which components are assembled and reassembled. The purpose has a broader than functional operational sense. And it is the reason that there is desire, desiring machine consistency that underlies the emergence of assemblages. As they say, desire is always assembly. It is what the assembly determines to be. For me, it is a very important statement for the analysis. In the case of the concepts involved in a problem under study are reconceptualized as assemblages and co-constituted in the space of assemblage that determine their situated definition and meaning. But because components, practices, and their place and time specific relationships vary, concepts have multiple actualizations. Thus, concepts are better conceived as multiplicities constituted by assemblages, as the legendary put it. This reconceptualization carries over to analysis, as I'll show later. So, the assemblage ontology enables a non-reductionist, integrated, context and issue-sensitive conceptualization, theoretical and analytical treatment of complex concepts, objects of reference, as concepts in use in socio-ecological and other studies. An example is from my research from human responses to land degradation, where I will talk about tomorrow more extensively about this, because the conventional understanding is that human responses are specific actions, while an effectiveness is assessed by means of conventional measures, indicators, whatever, while the assembly-based approach conceives them as response assemblages, which I define as historically unique, provisional, open territorial holds, complex compositions emerging from processes of assembling by physical instrument components from an affected focal and other socio-ecological system serve human goals. So land degradation and the responses to land degradation are not separate entities. It is the response assemblage that determines what they are, the state of an irradiated period. So, now, coming to theory building, the common approach to theorizing in applied studies is to adopt a micro or a macro reductionist economic or sociological approach, draw a general and abstract theoretical schema at best, and employ context-invariable concepts. Even the Panarchy model, which has been proposed by Bungerson and Holland to for socio-ecological studies, could not share this orientation. The assemblage-based approach addresses the need for substantive, context and issue-specific theorizing for the analysis and diagnosis of specific complex problems. The major implications of an assemblage-based approach to theorizing is a fundamental shift in framing and defining problems, conceptualizing concepts, identifying relationships, solving problems, making decisions from an essentialist and a reductionist approach to a processual relational, non-reductionist approach from the Euclidean space of externally defined systems as a whole to a multidimensional smooth space of multiplicities immanently constituted by diverse assemblies. That renders banners and typologies pointless, stage theories of linear socio-spatial development extraneous, and predetermined formal solutions revisable. Plan and policy implementation are open-ended and contingent on the place and time-specific mechanism through which heterogeneous components are assembled or disassembled. So their effects and outcomes are unpredictable. The most important consequence in applied context is that the formal-informal distinction for activities, settlements, planning, etc. becomes blurred and partially irrelevant because the formal informal boundary changes and formal concepts and processes are informalized during implementation, contextualization, translation, and so on, while informal processes may get formalized. What matters is the individual singularity of the assemblages that emerge. Note that informal does not necessarily mean unstructured. Informal may be very creative, coded, and organized as customary rules, laws, and institutions within. The assembly-based analysis now essentially becomes a simultaneous and irreversible operationalization of the spatio-temporal frame of reference and the style of structuration. This is a term introduced by Jane Bennett, which includes the composition and the processes of assemblages, which constituting the study multiplicity. The spatiotemporal frame of reference in implications is given a given focal socio-ecological system, which is usually defined following administrative boundaries often determined by those setting the problem and vested with formal mandate and power to apply pertinent recommendations, and it is considered as a system as a whole for the ensuing analysis. In assemblage-based analysis, the given focal socio-ecological system may be loosely conceived as a socio-ecological milieu, hosting a multiplicity defined by emerging assemblages. Analysis concerns individual focal assemblages and the emerging socio-spatial hierarchy identified within a period that may not coincide with the focal socio-ecological system and the current administrative hierarchy. Thus, the spatial frame of reference has to be redefined, anchored at the given focal system, but with a revisable and dynamic cross-level boundary. Similarly, the temporal frame of reference, which is also usually given at the outset, has to be redefined depending on the temporal reach and changes of the assemblages formed over time. Now, what to analyze, which assemblages to analyze? Focal assemblages associated with the problem under study, but also other assemblages which coexist, fold, and co-evolve with the focal one. What to analyze? The assemblages constituting the multiplicity, the associated socio-spatial hierarchy, the concepts of reference, the properties of assemblages, capacities and tendencies of components, their relationships among components. The important point is that all assessments concern the assemblages and not the system as a whole, because there is no such thing exists. Specification error, either to omit important components or to include unimportant, irrelevant components, is an important consideration due to missing data in that area. How it should be analyzed? The resources of non-linear analysis basically are used technically based on attraction and similar resources, which offer a fitting template to organize the thick analysis of assemblages via multi-method approaches and synthesis of quantitative and qualitative techniques. The main challenge is how to describe and analyze the relational, the processual, the actual process of relating and fitting and the emergent effects. Now, there are quantitative approaches like statistical analysis as not suitable because they model the outcomes of the process, not the processes themselves. There are two different orientations of approaches. One is cellular automata and agent-based modeling, which is reductionist, and the other is qualitative approaches, which are non-reductionist, narratives, hermeneutics, reason, history, informal reasoning, and so on, which, however, have different ontologies and they present an analytical challenge how to combine them. Other issues of analysis concern the availability of all required data, the limitation of conventional representation of resources and language to tell the full story of dynamic and the use of assemblages and the very incidence of specification error. Of course, we are using all kinds of data because knowledge of the world is acquired through all our senses. But the most important pieces of information, the speed missing, like experiential personal information, which cannot be easily accessed and explained. In application, the difference assembly-based approaches make is that the system as a whole is abandoned, is meaningless, and is replaced by the multiplicity and the assemblages that constitute it. Assemblages are not separated from their context, there is no inside and outside, because they are compositions in smooth multidimensional space, and consequently, analysis and assessment of resilience, effectiveness, etc., refer to and are meaningful for the assemblages identified, revealing how their style of structuration shapes particular outcomes in a period. Assembly-based approaches now, coming to policy and governance, change totally the basis of policy and governance discourse, how policy and governance issues are conceptualized, framed, and handled, because they reconceptualize the who, what, when, where, why, and how of socio-ecological and other problems. The common approach to policymaking is that a pre-given system as a whole exists, the administrative hierarchy where the problem arises, uniformly predefined concepts, purpose, effectiveness, etc., uniform also classes of target actors, farmers, businesses, etc., linear problem solving and policy process oriented towards uniform one-size-fits-all solutions and best practices. Solutions and responses to a problem are separately created, and usually they take a form, the form of specific instruments and implementation procedures that predetermine the recipients and administrators follow. Of course, practical necessities dictate several of these essentialist and reductionist assumptions that lead to, however, to implementation inefficiencies and ineffectiveness because reality does not conform to these assumptions. It is unclear if and how people perceive the problem, to what they collectively respond, if they respond to the problem as assumed by the policy, how solutions are implemented, and so on. People more often than not respond to more than one issue and pursue more than one goal. An assembly-based approach starts from the multiplicity of assemblages, emphasizes the emergent situated outcomes that may have been influenced by the formal policy measures. The problem and the solutions are not separate. The assemblage expresses the problem and its perception and embodies its solution. And however concrete and explicit the declared purpose of problem solving is, perception and purpose are being assembled in the course of making and implementing decisions. The actors involved evaluate the state and properties of the assemblages with the capacity to tendencies of the components, suggest alternative routes to follow, but most importantly, they practice, they perform the solution. when they implement recommendations. So solutions are not one size fits all, but situated, assembled and dynamic. The question of how to assess the effectiveness of policy measures, the common approach is to assess the value of predefined, usually general purpose measures of effectiveness, indicators, etc. But this is a mission impossible because it is unfeasible to neatly separate and orderly describe the formal, informal, local, supra-local, complex interactions among the components, to isolate the effects of a given policy from the effects of all other factors which are at play on the ground, to collect data to perform the analysis. In an assemblage-based approach, effectiveness is assembled in the space of particular assemblages and thus situated, composite and distributed. I have proposed a measure which I will discuss tomorrow, so I am not going to discuss this. Another question in policy making is, what is an effective point of intervention and means of intervention? The common approach is to assume that the predefined actors and means are to put a solution to the predefined problem to action, we linearly bring the desired result. The assembly-based approach, the problem definition and the solution as assembled. Basically, experimenting with the intervention that may encourage the emergence of more desirable assemblages is the way to follow. Interventions practically mean to either remove components and to modify their relationships. There is no perfect point of intervention. We just explore the implications from intervening in one component of the system on all other components and are prepared to cope with the repercussions. But the question in policy analysis is the desirable outcome is desirable to whom? So this brings us to questions of power and politics. In assemblage-based analysis, the assemblage-based analysis evinces the composite, distributed and emergent nature of power, the politics of the issue under study, and the influences of contingencies of the broader context. Thus, it helps explain power imbalances, the governability of assemblages, the persistence of observed and the non-occurrence of other outcomes. I skip the example here. And in this context of issues of power and politics, an important question is who produces what knowledge? The state of individual and collective, always imperfect knowledge, influences the description and explanation of assemblages and their related management decisions. Scientists and land resource users continuously produce scientific and traditional knowledge, collective knowledge of the mind-independent reality, and individuals constantly acquire knowledge through their senses. And there are two implications of the politics of power of knowledge and expertise in this context. Knowledge is socially constructed and situated, thus subject to uncertainty, and the system as a whole ontology becomes unsuitable for the study of real-world phenomena compared to the assemblage ontology that recognizes and enunciates their uncertain, volatile, revisable, and knowledge-dependent nature. So the open challenges are so many. I'm just going to hint at those I consider important. Assemblage is the proper ontology to study complex systems, and assemblage thinking sensitizes analysts and users of analysis to the open-ended and irrevisable nature of their objects of reference, shake belief in certainty and expert omniscience, and alert them to expect all possible outcomes. That poses important challenges. First of all, it offers an integrative conceptual apparatus and a flexible and malleable template to reconceptualize concepts as assembled and create an alternative lexicon for assembly-inspired substantive theory building through multidisciplinary synthesis of theories and traditional knowledge. It calls for methodological openness and pluralism, judicious and masterful synthesis of quantitative and qualitative techniques, and more importantly, development of novel analytical approaches, methodologies, and tools for relational analysis and representation. The growing list of diverse applications should be recommended to produce new theoretical and methodological thinking. Assembled thinking prompts a reconceptualization of formal and informal governance, a revision of governance approaches so far based on the system as a whole. The development and practice of assembly-based versions of adaptive governance, which is in fashion now, of real world intended formal and informal assembly. Notwithstanding the importance of the material agency, the role of personality demands particular attention because they are pivotal in encouraging the emergence of particular power assemblages and effecting their transformation into the political experience. Last but not least, assembly thinking calls for a re-examination of issues of ethics given the close relationship between the political and the ethical and the grounding of both on human and human material relations. Thank you.